بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه الطاهرين ما دام ما في السماوات والأرضين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. اللهم إنا نسألك علما ينفعنا وارفعنا. اللهم إنا نسألك ورزقا واسعا وعملا متقبلا وشفاء من كل داء. وبعده، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. كيف حالكم هذا اليوم؟ ما شاء الله. أحمد كامل الدين، أنت موجود حبيبي؟
السلام عليكم مولانا. أيوه
الحمد لله. أستاذ حبيبي،
الحمد لله، nice to see you مولانا.
بارك الله فيكم حبيبي.
الحمد لله.
Tell me man, next week, what's the program like next week?
I believe next week there's a dhikr مولانا.
Okay.
I think today is probably the last class.
Okay. Okay. And then so the next week thing, next week's gathering will be like in online or we meeting inshallah.
I see there was a proposal for two dates.
Okay.
That was sent out, so I think they haven't yet concluded on what. It's either Saturday the 5th or Sunday the 6th, but they haven't concluded yet on which date. There's like a survey that they sent out.
Okay, tamam. But the idea basically is to sort of like get together, is it? Like physically, yes. In the masjid and so.
Yeah, so I think that there'll probably be some people that want to attend in person and maybe some people online as well.
Okay, so basically the options are open for those who want to attend and then for the others. Khair, inshallah.
Yeah.
Barakallah feekum. Allah accept. So we've come to Surah Al-Talaq. What I was, this is the last class, right? So I'm thinking that we're not starting with the intention to finish really, but we should start either way. I don't know what you guys feel. Because also next week, if you have the dhikr and so forth, then there'll probably be parting words and advices and so forth given. So then we can take this opportunity in what remains of our time together to read a bit about Surah Al-Talaq, inshallah. Bismillah. So Ahmed, you keep your wasalim on, Habibi, so that I know there's somebody on the other side of the line, right?
Nah, I am your Mawlana, don't worry.
Okay, barakallah feekum. So we have started with Alhamdulillah Surah Al-Talaq. And we've mentioned a number of things by way of introduction, and also just in terms of giving a basic overview of the surah somewhat, walillah alhamd. And then spoken quite a bit about the concept of talaq itself. In prepping for today's lesson, I was reading again through the text, and I came across a narration from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, it was. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, there's a question which we will deal with later, and about the waiting period. If a lady is divorced and then she goes into a waiting period, so that waiting period is how long? That's the one question. The other question is, a lady is a widower, her husband passes on, so then she goes into a waiting period. So the one verse talks about 4 months and 10 days. That's very clear in terms of Surah Al-Baqarah. والذين يتوفون منكم ويذرون أزواجا يتربصن بأنفسهن أربعة أشهر وأشرا. Allah talks about a widower, a husband passes away, she will go into a waiting period for 4 months and 10 days. Is you okay with that, Ahmed?
Yes, Maulana.
Okay. Now what happens is sort of like juxtaposed to that is وأولات الأحمال أجلهن أن يضعن حملهن. A pregnant lady, say for whatever reason, not for whatever reason. A pregnant lady, her husband passes away. then she will also go into a waiting period. But how long is that waiting period? So our scholars say that her waiting period will come to an end when she gives birth. So we have two different types of ladies, and then the waiting period is determined differently. This particular matter was discussed with Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said to his companions, why are you making difficult that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made easy? Because according to some, they say that a pregnant lady, if her husband passes away, then we're going to look at the lengthier period. So if she's going to give birth in less than 4 months and 10 days, and then we're going to say that her waiting period is 4 months and 10 days, because 4 months and 10 days is the longer period. If she's very early on in terms of a pregnancy, and her pregnancy is going to extend for another 8 months, and then we're going to say, no, not 4 months and 10 days, you're going to wait the 8 months. So in other words, a longer period. So Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he takes exception to this, and he says to his companions, why are you making things difficult? Go with the view that says a waiting period comes to an end the moment she gives birth, irrespective of whether a day remains of a pregnancy, or whether a month remains, or whether a few months remain, and Allah knows best. The reason why I'm mentioning this particular incident is that we're going to discuss it later, inshallah, in terms of our class, in terms of the surah. But here, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud tells his companions, and he refers to Surah Al-Talaq. And the wording he basically uses would be Surah Al-Talaq. I'm going to just get the exact wording for you. Surah Al-Nisa Al-Qusra. Surah Al-Nisa Al-Qusra. So if you recall, when we met, the last time we met, we said that there are two chapters dealing with issues specifically relating to women folk, or the focus would be women folk, and that would become basically the fulcrum, it would become the axis upon which the chapter deals with. The one is Surah Al-Nisa, the one that appears after Surah Ali Imran, and that is what they refer to as Surah Al-Nisa Al-Kubra, the big chapter. And this one they refer to as Surah Al-Nisa Al-Qusra, in other words, the shorter chapter. So some scholars, like in Cape Town, they took exception with this particular naming, because how can you refer to a chapter as a small chapter? So then our scholars say that one isn't intending a small chapter in a diminutive sense, in a diminishing sense, but rather when you compare this chapter to the other longer chapter, then relatively speaking, in terms of its content, it is shorter. And therefore, there shouldn't be a problem in naming it like that. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So that's just a last thing that we would add in terms of by way of introduction. So thereafter, Surah Nisa Al-Qusra or Surah Al-Talaq, if you wanted to, start off in the following way. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Ya ayyuha an-Nabiyyu. إذا طلقتم النساء فطلقوهن لعدتهن. So here there are a number of issues. The first one is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off by saying يا أيها النبي. So maybe if I can just read till يا أيها النبي إذا طلقتم النساء. Just to highlight the point. يا أيها النبي. Ya ayyuha is harf nida, as we're familiar with, is made up of three letters, if you wanted to, or three parts. Ya, which is the harf nida, ayyu, which is generally a general word, and the ha attached to the end. So basically three parts, ya ayyuha. We simply translated as aw yu, ya ayyuha nabi. And then an-nabi, you clearly see that the word an-nabi, An-Nabi has an alif lam at the beginning. So alif lam, we have a number of alif lams. The alif lam here would be alif lam lil ahd. That tells you that you are familiar with whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about. Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu. The messenger, it could be any messenger. But because you and I, in terms of the Quranic context, when Allah says, oh messenger, we know exactly, at the very least by default, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to. It is not the other messengers. It is a specific messenger that you and I are familiar with, and it is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says, "Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu." That's the first thing. And we may have come across the word nabi before. What comes to mind now in terms of the word nabi? Where does it come from? Our scholars look at two sort of root origins in terms of the word Nabi. Some say it comes from the word Naba'a. Now the word Naba'a means to inform. So what is the one of the roles of the messenger? To inform us about Allah, first and foremost. And then to inform us about the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is Naba. And then you can sort of, I wouldn't say speculate, but you can apply that in terms of the whole process of revelation, that Allah informs Jibreel, Jibreel informs the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi sallam. So it is that he informs us, or he's the informed one, which is informed by Jibreel alayhi sallam. So you can apply that across the chain of transmission in terms of revelation. That's the one meaning they attach to it. The other meaning that they attach to it is Nabi from Nubu, which basically means to be high and to be exalted. And the status of a messenger is high and exalted. And then if you look at that particular meaning also, Sayyid Ahmad, you with us?
I'm here, Maulana.
So what you have is you have two meanings for the word Nabi. The one is to inform and the other one is to raise. Right?
Yeah.
So we looked at the term Naba'a. If you say it is to inform, then who's doing the informing and who's being informed? Across the, you know, almost like the this chain of transmission, what you can do is you can apply that inform, who's informing and who's being informed. So you apply it across that particular way. In the same way, Nubu comes from to raise, you know. So then if you apply that particular meaning, what happens? I think the most sensible meaning that comes to my mind would be the Prophet, what does he do? So he's a Nabi. So what does he do? He raises. What does he raise? He raises your level and he raises my level. And that's what a Nabi does. If you look at the fact that we are followers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what does it mean? It means that we were the last to come into this world, but we will be the first to enter into paradise. That's Nubu. That's what the Nabi does for us. He raises our status. Of the 120 lines that will enter into paradise, 80 of those lines will belong to the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is our Nabi. He's basically raised our status. It's like Imam al-Busiri says that because of the greater status that the Prophet ﷺ holds, likewise, his followers hold a greater status than the followers of any other messenger. So there you have the word Nabi basically packed out there for you. So ya ayyuhan Nabi, O Nabi, idha tallaqatum. Now I want you to notice now, said Ahmad, if you look at tallaqatum, ya ayyuhan Nabi is a single person. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala should have said, idha tallaqta. That when you, one male, when you issue a divorce, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say that. Allah says, إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمْ. So, طَلَّقْتَ is one, طَلَّقْتُمَا is two, طَلَّقْتُمْ is three. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using the plural form. يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِيُّ إِذَا طَلَّقْتُمْ. So, what do we learn therefrom? What do we learn therefrom is that who's being addressed? Is it only the messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who's being addressed? Or is it everybody else that's being addressed? It is everybody. So then the next question which comes to mind, why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala structure this verse in this particular manner? So Allah is talking to all of us. So he could have said, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, idha talaqtum an-nisa, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because then you have a plural there, and then you have a plural, and then there's like this congruence in terms of the verse. But now it seems somewhat, you know, Ya ayyuhan nabi, you owe nabi, Allah is talking to the nabi, and then Allah says, إِذَا طَلَّقَتُمْ, when you all enter into a divorce. In other words, when you divorce your wives. So what's the, you know, what's the theory behind that? So our scholars explain, and they say that the reason why, you know, it's almost like, because I'm speaking to the whole class, barakallahu fikum jami'an, but it is Ahmad that I'm getting in an interlocution with. So what happened is, said Ahmad, I want you to do something. I want your family to do something. Let's say I want your family to come out and assist us in the dhikr that we're having next week in terms of the logistics, right? So what happens is the one option is I say, Kamruddin's, right?
Yes.
That's the one option. You follow me, Habibi. Alternatively, what happens is because you are the leader of your household, right? And basically, they're going to take directive from you. So what do I say? I say to you, oh, Ahmad, right? So I'm addressing a single person. Then The family should come out to assist us in terms of the logistics next weekend, Saturday. You follow?
Yes, sir.
Why am I addressing you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does it in the same way. The Nabi, he's ultimately responsible for conveying the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah addresses him.
Yeah.
And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala includes all of us by extension. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. It's also very important because not nowadays, but I think in terms of our learning, and it depends also entirely from which sort of circle that you come from. One of our scholars I'm thinking now, Sheikh Mukhtar al-Maghrawi, hafidhahullah wa ra'ah, he had a particular learning, you know, like Islamic studies, right? So perhaps I should explain this thing from the outset. You know, Ahmed, if you have in terms of studying, particularly initially, when you're studying, you shouldn't be all over the place, man. You follow me, Sadi?
Yes.
So what happens is you have one teacher and you have, it's like a doctor, man. Look, you're going to get varying opinions, right? And yes, you can get a second opinion, a third opinion. But if you're going to go around and get every doctor's opinion, by the time you finish with the doctors, you're maningal already.
Yeah.
You follow me, Habib?
I follow Maulana.
Now what happens is the same applies when, especially in the initial stages, when you start to study, do you do your diligence in terms of, you know, ascertaining whether this is a reliable teacher or not, right? But once you get a reliable teacher, what you must do now is that you limit yourself to that particular reliable teacher. It will save you a lot of trouble, right? So that is the first, that is a very important advice, right? You find students, particularly initially, they're in the first year, second year, third year, but they're running all over the place. And then what it does, as opposed to, it sometimes has like unintended negative consequences. The intentions are all very good, but unintended negative consequences, and one of that is, as opposed to moving forward and gaining a forward momentum through knowledge, people are more confounded and more confused. Sometimes in that particular instance, the student is to blame and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So having one teacher is a good thing. But now as you progress, what happens is it's also good because we come from certain circles, man, and certain backgrounds. So I'm on to the second point now, Ahmed.
Yes.
The first point that we, I think we can agree upon. The second point now is that it's also, so you must balance the one out with the other one. We come from certain backgrounds, man.
Can I ask a question or first one, Maulana?
Bismillah.
So what about just getting maybe a second or third opinion, you know, instead of just sticking with one view?
No, you have an absolute license to do that, Habibi. You can get a second view, you can get a third view, and there's absolutely no problem in that. To be honest with you, initially I thought to myself that is, you know, that is problematic, because you know what they call it? They call the guy fatwa shopping.
Yeah.
So maybe, I don't know if you asked yesterday, it was Black Fridays, or maybe yesterday or the day before. You know, Black Friday, so now what happened is you can go fatwa shopping and you get a discount also.
Understand, Maulana.
Initially, I thought that's a big problem, but it's not a problem actually, because a lay person, he's got to go to somebody that he has reliance on. He goes to one person, the person gives him an answer. He's not too comfortable with that particular answer. I'm talking now when things are done genuinely and, you know, with a good intention. Right? Yeah. Not maybe to seek out whatever the case may be. Even if it is to seek out an easier opinion, no problem. The guy has a license to go for another option as long as it's within the ambit of the Sharia, no problem. So you can get a second opinion, third opinion. What I'm highlighting is sometimes an unintended consequence of that particular process is what happens is you're confused. Yeah. Now you don't know what to do. As I go with fatwa number one, fatwa number two, fatwa number three. So that's basically what I'm cautioning against.
Shukra.
So legally you have that right. You can go all over the place, but going all over the place, it does come with problems, you know. And that's the, I think all of us on a psychological level, all of us can appreciate, you know, how problematic it is when you have too many options. I mean, normal day-to-day life. You just have so many options, you don't know what to do. Exactly the same thing applies when you go fatwa shopping and then now you have so many options, you don't know what to do.
Confuse yourself.
You confuse yourself at the end of the day. And sometimes worse now, then what happens is the guy comes to me. I'm number four now, Ahmed.
Yeah.
And now I'm number four. And then you
come to you first, Maulana.
Nah, what happens? I'm four. I like to be number four. Because I tell you why, for this reason, the guy comes to me and he's starting off, he says, I went to all the ulama. None of them have an answer for me. Oh, you see, now you have it. Now you get into trouble, and they will have a problem now. So that was the idea behind it. Allah reward you and increase your own gold. Now, so that's the first point. Second point now is we come from different backgrounds, right? Ahmed, you come from a certain background. I come from a certain background, right? Now that background, we focus on it. Now, you know, when you focus on something, then what happens is automatically, again, since we are talking about psychologically, you focus so on one thing that what happens, you have certain blind spots. You follow? Yeah. You focus on one thing. And this is now not a, I'm not saying this to, this psychologists say, like, if you focus, I tell you, look, focus on this and count out the numbers. And then what happens is I have somebody walk across your view, right? Chances are, and not like 50-50, chances are that if I'm sitting here by my window, right? I'm looking out and I'm looking onto the street. If I were to put like 15 dummies over there and I ask you, Ahmed, please count all of those dummies, right? And you're so focused on counting the dummies. And then afterwards I ask you, Ahmed, how much dummies were there? You tell me 15. Did you get it right?
Yes.
Yes, you got it. But what happened now is I tell you, Ahmed, did you notice the car that went past? You tell me what car?
Yeah.
And then I record what you did, and then I play you the video recording, and then you see the car going past. But you were so busy counting the dummies that you didn't see the car. So we come from different backgrounds, right? So what happens is you come from these backgrounds. We have some blind spots to these backgrounds. Therefore, the second thing what I want to mention now is it's good sometimes to broaden your horizons in terms of learning. That you learn from, you have some, you know, like you have some, you have teachers, reliable teachers. But then also you have, to a certain degree, like a broad spectrum of reliable teachers. So what happens is some blind spots that you may have had here and there, what happens is those are remedied. You follow me, Sir Ahmed?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Now, why am I mentioning all of that? I'm mentioning all of that because we're talking about Yayu and Nabi. And we said now that Allah says Yayu and Nabi. People are asking me nowadays, one person told me, and I respect the view, he says, we believe in prophethood. Right? So I said, 100%. But listening to one of my talks in terms of a Friday introducing the Prophet, he says, but, you know,